Good afternoon, everybody. So I would like to give you all a warm welcome, those who are here as well as those who are joining us online, to the next session, which is going to be a guest lecture. And on behalf of the Sri Lanka College of Dermatologists, I would like to thank Sri Lanka Medical Association for giving us this opportunity to present at this prestigious event. And I would like to introduce a speaker who is Dr. Naini Madhurasingha, who is currently working as the consultant dermatologist at Infectious Diseases Hospital, Angoda. And she was the immediate past joint secretary of the Sri Lanka College of Dermatologists. And she is also the chairperson of the cosmetic subcommittee of the Sri Lanka College of Dermatologists and a very active member of the fungal task force of the college. So she will be talking to you on a very interesting topic, which is looking good in the new world. Over to you, Naini.
Thank you. We will now move on to a different topic, that is maintaining your beauty in the new normal. So once the lockdown period was over and the country reopened, we were enforced with face masks, frequent hand washing, increased bathing, and maybe with the new work shifts, more time for self-care. So face masks could be this trendy, but I'm not going to talk about these, but a dermatologist's perspective of face masks. What is your concept of facial beauty? This is Queen Nefertiti from ancient Greece, and this was an icon of female beauty. When you talk about facial beauty, it is all about facial diameters and facial symmetry. An ideal human face can be divided into three sections with horizontal lines, and this was even introduced by Leonardo da Vinci in his ancient writings on human anatomy. Not only horizontally, it can be divided into five vertical sections, which equals to a diameter of one eye. And then there's this golden ratio, which is also known as phi. This is also can be observed in nature, art, and architecture. This approximately equals to the number 1.618. And it is very interesting to note that in ideal face proportions, there are several measurements that comes into this magical number. Therefore, it is also considered as a marker of beauty in the human face. There are numerous studies which have shown that there are no statistical significant differences of these facial proportions in celebrities, where there are significant differences in normal controls. However, the concept of beauty is very subjective, and there are ethnic differences and age-related differences. Now, in the new normal, you can sit and relax. We don't have to worry about all these facial proportions. The only part that is visible is this area. However, this is considered to be the most attractive part of the face and also the one which can reveal all emotions. Can you guess these different emotions? So if this is the only part which is visible, it is very important that we have that part as beautiful as possible. So what will happen if we develop this condition? This is periorbital darkening, which is a very common problem, especially in Asian skin. And the causes are multifactorial, like it could be genetic or constitutional, or due to post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation, secondary to atopic dermatitis or contact dermatitis, due to periorbital edema, increased vascularity, especially in fair skin, shadowing due to laxity, or tear trough. Tear trough is the groove in the infraorbital region. Treatment is a challenge. Topical agents alone may not be helpful. Therefore, it is very important to identify the cause of this. And most of the time, the causes are multifactorial. Topical skin lightening agents, together with other procedures like chemical peels, fillers, and sometimes platelet-rich plasma will be helpful. This is an indication where a synthetic filler has been injected in the infraorbital region to reduce the groove and also to reduce the periorbital darkness. Then the forehead. It is a known thing that a person's age can be relieved with a number of lines in the forehead. So these are the dynamic lines which occur when one moves the facial muscles. When these muscles are used repeatedly, there's another type of lines which occurs even when the facial muscles are at rest. So these are known static lines. So when these dynamic lines are there for a long period, the static lines occurs. So actually there's a belief that we are not too old to get these wrinkles treated. But that is not the case, because we have to treat these dynamic lines in order to prevent the static lines from occurring. So the treatment for dynamic lines is neurotoxins. That is, the neurotoxins will block the acetylcholine release at the neuromuscular junction, causing a chemical denervation. And that reduces muscle contraction and soften the dynamic wrinkles. You can see a remarkable improvement in this patient who has had her neurotoxins for the forehead dynamic wrinkles. And this effect occurs in 7 to 10 days, and it will last for nearly 4 months. Then about the skin problems related to the face mask. We have to consider on this part as well, because there will be a time that we can walk about without using the face mask. Face masks can cause erythema, scaling, and maceration. These are the most commonly reported side skin-related issues. And then contact and pressure urticaria, contact dermatitis, aggravation or induction of acne, and aggravation of any existing skin disease. Acne due to face mask is mostly due to the mechanical irritation. This is known as mechanical acne. And also the exhaled air will get entrapped between the sclerosed area between the face mask and the skin, causing a warm, moist environment, which is an ideal environment for the propionibacterium acne to grow in. So all these factors will contribute to the aggravation or induction of acne with face mask. And you can see that it is confined, this acne is confined to the area which is covered by the face mask. Erythema, persistent erythema is mainly due to the pressure effect due to prolonged use of face masks. And then one can get contact dermatitis. When the face mask is used, the natural skin moisturizing factors are absorbed by the fabric, and the skin becomes dry, coming into a more irritated state. And some people can develop allergies to the ingredients of the synthetic ingredients of the fabric or due to the dye. So they can develop this contact dermatitis on these areas. As for prevention, we can limit the time of wearing face mask. Use of mild facial cleansers is very important, because the skin is already at an irritated state. Therefore, the use of harsh cleansers can make the problem worse. And also, adequate moisturizing is very important before you wear the face mask. Next is frequent hand washing. This has even become like a part of our life now. However, there are several adverse effects on frequent hand washing. One is disruption of the skin barrier, which could be either epidermal permeability barrier or the microbial barrier. And also, there are adverse effects on skin pH. Few words about skin barrier. The epiderm is comprised of mainly four layers, with the outermost layer, the stratum corneum, acting as the epidermal barrier. And the stratum corneum is consisting of two components. One is the corneocytes, which are the nucleolus flattened cells. And these corneocytes are embedded in the lipid-rich matrix. Inside the corneocytes, there are aggregation of keratin filaments, which are aggregated by a protein called filaggrin. And when this filaggrin is degraded, it will form into a molecule called natural moisturizing factor. This corneocyte lipid bilayer is also known as the Brecken motor module, and this serves as an epidermal permeability barrier, reducing the transepidermal water loss. And also, the natural moisturizing factor in the corneocytes has the capacity to hold water and maintain the skin hydration. What is the effect of soap and water in the epidermal permeability barrier? The soap will act strongly to the proteins in the corneocytes, and the corneocytes can get damaged, and also the enzymes in the corneocytes can damage, which will disrupt the process of skin maturation and desquamation. And also the soap can wash away the lipids. So when the corneocyte lipid bilayer is destructed, there will be more water leaking out of the epidermis. And at the same time, when the these additions are broken, the natural moisturizing factors can get washed away. So this comes like a vicious cycle, which will in turn lead to more spills occurring in the epidermis. Therefore, more soap and water can leak in, and then the skin is more vulnerable for damage in a future washing cycle. Effect on skin pH. As you know, soap is alkaline, whereas the skin pH is maintained acidic. The increased pH after the use of soap can cause swelling of the corneocytes and ionize fatty acids and destabilize the lipid bilayer. Again, this disruption of the corneocyte lipid bilayer can give rise to impaired barrier function, which will lead to this return contact dermatitis, clinically manifesting as erythema, scaling, and fissuring. The other important factor is the microbial barrier. So with the disruption of the barrier, the skin becomes more vulnerable for exogenic pathogens, leading to numerous infections. How can we prevent this? One is choosing the correct cleansing agent, which is mild on skin yet serves the purpose. There are different soaps and soap substitutes, as well as hand sanitizers, which can be used for hand washing. And these, by their chemical composition, vary. With their variation of the, in the chemical compositions, their effect on the skin dryness and the pH can vary. Actually, I'm not going into details of this, but it will be important to know that it's not soap always, like there are different kinds of soaps. Now we will see that what is the correct cleansing agent. It is known that if you are using hand sanitizers, we have to use alcohol-based hand sanitizers. And soap substitutes are not proven to be effective against the viral clearance. Non-soap baths or scented baths, actually I could not come into good evidence to show that they are effective. Therefore, without having a dilemma, we can remove that as well. Basic soaps, that are usually the cheap soaps which can be used for any washing purpose. It is effective in the viral clearance, but harsh on the skin. So actually we are left with these options. And antimicrobial soaps are not providing any added benefit in viral clearance. Therefore, we can actually go with the normal soaps and the hand sanitizers. We can't prevent the washing, but we can do things to restore the barrier. So frequent moisturizing of the hands after each washing episode is important to keep the skin barrier intact and prevent the return contact dermatitis, which we commonly see nowadays. Then the frequent bathing. Again, as for the soap, it is the effective cleansing with minimal irritation of the scalp that we aim. So the primary component of any shampoo is the surfactant system. The purpose of this is the cleansing purpose, and also it is responsible for the lathering action. In addition, there are a wide variety of other materials which will give the added benefits, like the thickness, fragrances, and the viscosity adjusters. Especially with frequent bathing, it is important that you use a hair conditioner as well, because there are various other chemical substances which are there to give added value in a hair conditioner. Silicones will give a shiny, manageable hair, and cationic polymers has a detangling and anti-static effect, and humectants are very important to maintain the hydration of the hair. Few words about dandruff or seborrheic herpetes. Normal scalp has a colonization of Malassezia yeast, and under certain conditions, this yeast can become pathogenic, initiating skin reactions which include inflammation and hyperproliferation, and this will give rise to scaling and itching. So if you want to treat dandruff, you have to reduce the Malassezia colonization, and you have to use shampoos with active antifungal component. When this is a thing that can recur often, so when you are using antifungal shampoo, it is important that it should be continued as a maintenance. An alternative use of a cosmetic shampoo will reduce the efficacy. And also, if you are using a conditioner, it is important to use a one with the anti-dandruff effect as well. Now, the last component, more time for self-care. So it is important that we know what we have to do to maintain our routine skincare. So actually, when it comes to routine skincare, we should not disturb the normal cellular architecture of the skin. So less is more when it comes to skin. Cleansing, I have touched this part earlier. So you have to gently wet with lukewarm water with fingertips with the use of a mild cleanser or soap substitute. And we have to avoid vigorous scrubbing and then rinse and pat dry with a soft towel. Moisturizing is very important, especially with aging. Because of the structural changes that occur in the epidermis, the transepidermal water loss increases and the skin becomes dry. And this will also have an effect on the appearance of wrinkles. So we have to use a moisturizer to maintain the hydration and prevent the dryness. And the choice of the moisturizer will depend on your skin type. Photo protection. Again, another important thing in routine skincare. Before elaborating on this, I will give you a basic introduction on aging. Like, the skin changes are the most visible signs of aging. And there are two types of aging. One is the intrinsic or chronological aging, which is the genetically determined aging process where we don't have any control upon. But then you have the extrinsic aging, where photo damage will play about 80% of the this component. So that is a very significant component that we can minimize, actually. So this is a computer-generated picture of a person at the same age, which shows the chronological aging only in one picture, and then the other one with the added photo-aging component. So you can actually imagine how much the visible aging process that we can minimize by using adequate photo protection. So when using doing photo protection, it is very important to select a proper sunscreen, and this should be a broad spectrum one with an adequate coverage of both UVA and UVB. And if you are having a pigmentary problem, it is advisable to cover the coverage of visible light as well. And the SPF factor has to be 30 or higher. The application of the sun creams are also important. It has to be at least 15 minutes before going out, and even on cloudy days, and it has to be reapplied every 2 to 3 hours and after getting into water or sweating. And it has to be, to get the maximum benefit, it has to be applied in an adequate amount as an even layer. And it is not only creams, the other measures of sun protection has also be borne in mind. And if you are wearing a hat, it is important that you wear a wide-brimmed hat which will adequately protect you from sunlight. And the other one is the photo pigmentation, especially in the new normal. If you are going out, we are going out with the face mask. If you want to prevent this, make sure that you use adequate photo protection. And then the anti-aging creams, especially after the age of 30s, these should be part of your armamentarium of self-care. Retinoids, which is the best proven anti-aging cream. And then there are the other ones as hydroxy acids, antioxidants and vitamins, and proteins and peptides. It is not only this, avoiding smoking, having stress-free life, adequate sleep, and multicolored vegetables and fruits, which will provide you plenty of antioxidants, are also important in having a fresh, healthy skin. So I think I have given you a few tips on maintaining your beauty amidst a pandemic. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nani. Thank you, Nani, for that very interesting talk. Are there any questions from the audience? We haven't had any questions from via WhatsApp. Any questions from the audience?
Don't go in the sun.
Yes, madam. Like, if the glare is coming, then even if you are inside, if there's some amount of sunlight coming, yes.
Very interesting presentation. Thank you. estrogens, isn't it? Estrogen.
It is one factor, and most of the pigmentary problems are aggravated by photo exposure.
Yeah, I think there's one question which I haven't received yet.
It depends on the concentration. Actually, there are certain cosmetic creams which are just available in the market, which has a another group of retinoid and a milder group of retinoid with a lower concentration. But the proper concentrations are the ones that are prescribed by dermatologists.
Question from Zoom. Can you hear me?
Moisturizing agent, yes.
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
What I would like to know is the public health aspect of these cosmetics and their advertisements. Claims are made. We do not know whether they are true or not. What is the regulation of these advertisement of these cosmetics and their claims? You've had vitamin preparations which are good for the skin. I have seen no evidence for application of vitamin preparations for the skin. Could you please comment on that? Thank you.
Actually, all these cosmeceuticals should be registered under the NMRA, that is the National Medicine and Regulatory Authority. But there was a problem in Sri Lanka because this process was not happening over the last few years. But now the system has come back to normal, and we are actually doing the registration of all the cosmetics before it comes into the market.
And the question is slightly different, because I asked about the regulation of advertisements.
If I may add something to that.
Is there a regulation or not?
Yeah, actually, I think first we need the registration of these cosmetics, as well as the new Cosmetics Act is going to be passed in Parliament. So that is in the draft stage. Once the legal framework at the moment is not strong enough for anyone to take actions against these advertising and things like that. So I think once the legal framework is in place, even now there is an advertisement, monitoring of advertisements, but not to the extent that we would like it to happen. At the moment, as far as we know, what's happening is, if you want to advertise, if you want to get the green light, you submit. The things that are not submitted are not monitored. So when we can bring that extent, like when every advertisement is monitored, I think we can do something about it. But until then, there are certain shortcomings there.
What about the College of Dermatologists and the SLMA having a web page which looks at the most egregious advertisements and pointing them out as a part of the public education and responsibility towards the consumers in Sri Lanka? Don't wait for legislation. Have a website and say these advertisements are not supported by scientific evidence.
Yes, actually, Sri Lanka College of Dermatologists, actually, I would say that we are doing our level best to make things streamlined in this cosmetic industry. So we will consider your option as well. Thank you.
We'll put this presentation onto the Sri Lanka Dermatologist website and also make some pointed comments about the false advertisements that are at present that would help the public of Sri Lanka. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nayani, for that interesting lecture and also the lively discussion. And since we are running short of time, I think it's time for us to end this session. Thank you very much.